Good morning, children. I've been talking to you about Christmas, and I've talked to you about what Christmas is all about. And just a short recap, the story of Christmas is told in two books of the Gospels, two of the Gospels, Matthew and Luke. And in the first two chapters of each, that is a total of four chapters, tell us about the story of Christmas. And last week I shared with you what Christmas is. And I shared with you about some people who show us what Christmas is about. I talked about Mary, who received an impossible task and performed it, was willing to accept it. I spoke about Joseph, who in a dream also was told what God's will was, and he accepted it. I spoke to you about the shepherds to whom the angels appeared, simple, uneducated, down-to-earth people, and the angels gave them God's word. They accepted God's word, not only accepted, but they went out and they shared it. I spoke about the wise men, those who are scholars, those who are learned. To them also came a miracle, the miracle of a moving star. Some people think that they were led by astrology. Not so. They were led by the miracle of a moving star. Stars are fixed in the heavens. They move with the time, but this was a new thing, a phenomenon, a moving star. And they accepted the leading of the moving star where it led them to Christ. Also, there was a man in Jerusalem, an old man by the name of Simon. And he accepted the leading of the Holy Spirit because his desire was to see the promised one of God. And the Holy Spirit, God's Spirit, told him that you will see in your own lifetime. And so he spent his whole days and nights in the temple waiting for the fulfillment of that promise. And when he saw this young couple coming with a baby into the temple, God's Spirit told him, this is the promised child. This is the one who will take away the sins of the world. And so Simon accepted the leading of the Holy Spirit. Now today I would just like to share with you about what Christmas should not be. And here also I will take a few people from the narratives in the book of Matthew and in the book of Luke. First of all, in the book of Luke, this is what we read in chapter 2. It says, Mary and Joseph, they went to be registered because an order was given by the emperor, the Roman emperor, that he wanted a census taken of all the people. And the people had to go back to their hometown to get their names registered, just like we have census in our country. They had to go back, and it says that because Joseph was from Bethlehem, he was of the house and lineage of David, so he went to Bethlehem to be registered with Mary, his fiancée, who was with child. A journey of 250 kilometers in order to get registered. And it says in verse 6, while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes and cloths, and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. There was no place for them in the inn. The little village of Bethlehem had no place for them. There was no place in the inn, no homes opened their door to allow him to come in and the baby to be born there. There was no room. Are we like that? So busy, our lives so full with activity, with friends, with all the celebrations, with the parties, with the gifts, that there is no room for the one who really matters. Then let me talk to you about another, and this is a city, and this is in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 2, and this is about the wise men. It says, After Jesus was born in Bethlehem, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and have come to worship him." Now, verse 3, listen carefully. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born, and they told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet." Now see here, three people. Firstly, it says Herod the king was troubled. Why was he troubled? He was afraid he was going to lose his throne. Because these people said, these wise men said, "Where is he who is born king of the Jews?" And he said, "I am the king. No baby is born in my house. Who is this king of the Jews?" And so he was worried about his own position. And so he was troubled. And not only troubled, later on in the same chapter we read, he made active plans to kill the baby. Herod was troubled and tried to kill Jesus. Then there is a second group, and this says this whole city of Jerusalem was troubled. Strange. Jerusalem was a place where the temple of God was. One would imagine that the people of this place would be thinking of God, would be worshipping God, would be reading God's word, and they would be concerned about things of God. But what do we read about the city of Jerusalem? The whole city of God's troubled. Now, there are some who are troubled, some who are actively against and try to destroy, and some who are troubled because this Jesus who is born is not going to give you the peace as we think of it. Things are not going to be easy. And so they are troubled. Who is this? Now there's a third group that we see. And this is the chief priests and scribes of the people. And these are the people who read God's word, and they knew, in fact, they gave the answer when the King Herod asked, "Where should he be born?" They didn't know. No newspapers, no news. Where should he be born? They knew the Bible, and they said, "It is written in the Bible, in the Old Testament, 700 years before Jesus was born, it was written, he will be born in Bethlehem." And they said, "Yes, the coming king is to be born in Bethlehem." These were people who knew God's word. And yet, we don't read that any one of them said, "Okay, he's going to be born in Bethlehem, so let's go. Let's go and see. What a wonderful thing. Prophecy of 700 years old prophecy fulfilled today. Let's go and see." None of the scribes, none of these Pharisees, none of son. And he had been told by an angel that your son is the one who will go before the Christ and will proclaim his coming. So they had this miracle before them also, that just 3 months ago, this baby was born to Zechariah, and Zechariah said, this boy will be the forerunner of the Christ. These scribes, these Pharisees knew all this, and yet they never went to see the Lord Jesus Christ. Today, what are you and who are you? Are you going to be willing to accept the difficult task God may give you? Are you willing to accept and open your hearts to let Him live there the true meaning of Christmas? Or are you going to be troubled? Are you going to feel hatred, inimical, or just indifferent? I don't care. It's up to you. Choice is yours. Christmas is here. Christmas is all about giving gifts. God gave, what will you give? God gave, and that we read in John 3:16. Anybody here can tell me what is John 3:16? We have said it so many times. Anybody? Okay, alright. Okay, oh my goodness, so many hands. That's the true gift and present of Christmas, John 3:16, please. Let it be done, let it be on you.
For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, for whosoever may believe in Him shall not perish but have eternal life.
Okay, so that's the gift of Christmas. God loved, God gave His only Son, that whoever believes on Him will not ever die, have eternal life. Yeah? But do you know, Christmas is not just getting presents, it's also giving presents. So what's the present you are going to give God? So you've heard of John 3:16. Have you heard of 1 John 3:16? John 3:16 is God's gift to you. 1 John 3:16 is your gift to God. And let me read it out to you. And this is what it says. By this we know love, because Jesus laid down His life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. Jesus gave His life for us. That's the gift of Christmas. Now we are to love each other and to be ready to give our life for each other. And that is our gift to God. May God bless this season for you. May you have a wonderful Christmas. May it be a Christmas for you like it was for Mary, for Joseph, like it was for the shepherds, for the wise men, and for Simon. Have a very good week.